Hello and welcome to another episode of Gardens of Ventura County, the program that brings you the finest gardens, commercial growing operations, landscapes here in Ventura County. Ventura County, as you know, is a wonderful Mediterranean climate. Everything grows just fabulously here in Ventura County. Today we're revisiting the Art City Stone Gardens established by famous sculptor Paul Lindhard. And when we get back, we're going to be interviewing Paul Lindhard. Right here on Gardens of Ventura County. So glad you could join us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the program, ladies and gentlemen. And as I promised, we are here with famous sculptor Paul Lindhard, the proprietor here at Art City Stone Gardens, and also at the famous Art City right down the street here on Dubbers Lane in West Ventura. Welcome to the program, Paul. Thanks for having us back.
Thanks, Rob.
And today is a very special event. It's the annual Art City Stone Gardens Solstice event. Is that correct?
Summer solstice, yeah.
Summer solstice. What can you tell us about the summer solstice event here at Art City Stone Gardens, Paul?
Well, it's the longest day of the year. It's a transitional time from the spring into summer. It's what we normally do with the garden. The garden part of the stone garden is plant food. And today we put a bunch of starts in. We'll do it through the end of the week. And it's to kind of, it's an effort to bring community together. We grow more food than we can eat here. It's all organic, and I'm providing the water, so it's just an idea around bringing community together. Then the stones are my personal passion. The collection of these pieces is an accumulation of probably 2 decades of finding these rocks, getting them bottom cut, preparing them for situations. And I didn't know exactly that my own work was going to be really deeply involved with landscape. I mostly started out making small tabletop objects and that kind of thing. But most of the work I do now, I do in landscapes.
You're also a commissioned artist to do municipal installations of stone sculpture work. Is that correct?
Public art. And in the past, a lot of my public art had to be landscape. Maybe with a lawn, maybe with something that would now not be appropriate. We don't have the water for that. So these are setups, this bench area, these seating stones, are arrangements that could be in a public park, a municipality, or a large estate, or a recreational facility, some kind of place.
And stones, as we know, don't need much watering.
Zero maintenance. The next phase in this garden will be to work with a couple of local rock plants that make crushes and stuff. It's a lot less sexy than an incredible stone like this, but if I frame it, besides in this golden dirt, which is what some of the rocks in the area would become, with fines of 2-inch and 3-inch and 1/4-inch parts, I can create bullseyes and paths and create a kind of isolated canvas, if you will, for the look of the pieces. And so that'll help people understand that this could be a landscape as without a lot of water use.
Wonderful. Well, that's what I love about the Art City Stone Gardens. There's this morphing, it's constantly evolving with your genius and your design capabilities into a different look every single year. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have never been to the Art City Stone Gardens, we're located just off of Olive Street, off of Main Street and the Vaughn Shopping Center on Dubbers Lane. And just down the street, 2 lots down, is Paul's original business, Art City Stoneworks.
Art City Studios.
Art City Studios, where sculptors have spaces where they can work on their craft and also purchase stone. And landscapers come and they purchase stone from Paul. Tell us more about your Art City business.
Well, the stone business part of Art City was initially, and kind of still, was for me to support my habit. This whole place here is a manifestation of my habit of collecting special stones, like I work for the rocks kind of thing. And the accumulation I have in the yard draws a lot of artists, which creates an artist community, because it's a unique selection of material for people to draw from. And the same goes with landscape entities. And those jobs tend to generate work for the various artists in the yard.
And you're well known for going all over the Southwest and even to Mexico to find quarries that have the stones that you desire to offer from Art City, correct?
That's correct.
Tell us about some of your quarry locations. You don't have to give away specific locations, but give the folks at home an idea of where Art City stones come from.
All right, well, all of this granite here, I can give away the proprietary secret. It comes from a quarry that just got closed. And so saving them became, like, in the moment, I had to do it. I had to get this enormous collection, 3 semi-loads, 180,000 pounds of stone in here in one time with a crane. So I only used the crane one time. And that was a huge effort that, I mean, I don't know what I'll get around to carving. This rocket's mostly done. But it was a huge effort to save these stones, or I'd have never had access to them again.
Wow, and if you hadn't grabbed them, they would be still sitting in a closed-down quarry somewhere, is that right?
No, they'd get crushed. They'd be gravel.
They'd be roadway by now.
Yeah, they weren't going to sell to artists any longer. It's not what you call a really profitable thing. I could tell you, because I sell rock to artists, too.
Right.
But ironically, my business supports me now more than I support the business.
Where are some of the other locations where you've quarried your rock from, Paul?
Well, I go to a place in New Mexico, in Belen, that's south of Albuquerque, and then out into the mountains, 50 miles on a dirt road. It's a fabulous location. And 3 weeks from now, I'm going down to Baja, California, to an onyx mine that I've been going to since I was a kid. It's going to be a fun trip other than the heat. I mean, I wouldn't want to be there this week. Who knows what it's going to be like in 2 weeks from now. I'm hoping for a hurricane.
Exactly. My favorite is the translucent orange, yellow-orange calcite. Where do you quarry that from?
Well, I don't quarry it. I buy it from a quarry in above Park City, Utah. And so it's actually mined up at 10 to 12,000 feet. And so they can only work it a few months a year.
Before we get to the gardens along the perimeter of Art City Stone Gardens here, Paul, I've been attracted to your latest installation, this capstone and this installation behind us. What can you tell us about this installation?
Well, this is a natural stone, natural flat bottom, the top on it. It's the natural flat that's pretty rare. It's granite. It's the southern Sierra granite, and it's pretty much identical to the granites of the Sierras proper. I mean, very much identical. That stone came from just below Yosemite, and the stone bench back there, and this collection came from below Yosemite. All the rest of it came from down by Escondido. And so once I found this stone, I just had to get 3 legs to put it on, and I got one perfect one. One a little short, that one's going to have a stone donut surrounding the pipe. And then this one, which has this sawn surface, which is architectural, it's man-made looking, but it lends itself to pictive stuff, you know, sandblasted story.
Would you be adding any pictograms of your own over the next 100 years or so people would know you were who you were? The story of Art City Stone Gardens, perhaps, in pictogram form?
Yeah, I don't know if that's what'll go on here, but these are my stories, so I'm laying the seeds to a big story for longevity. I collect these stones from where they come from, and I know the nature of the skins and the textures on them. I hang out with them before I determine to spend thousands of dollars to purchase them and bring them here and chuck them and crane them and do those things. They are a part of nature's voice that I think I can amplify or share with, in the case of finding really great shapes, like this natural flat and these connecting stones, I'm able to have a head start on a sculpture that I would have never maybe thought of if I was just wanting to do a dune in a pose, you know, kind of a thing, because I might not ever find that rock. But you start with the rock, and then the rock doesn't really need to become a dude in a pose or a woman in a pose. It might have a sort of presence that's the rock story. You know, and it's trademark in my own work that I use a lot of the natural surfaces of the stones I collect from nature in the finished piece. Create that contrast to show where it came from, to use it as a voice, if you will, for the notion of nature having a voice. If we all thought that foxes and chickens and rabbits and mice really had a voice too, then it might be a more harmonious way to live. And the same goes with the stones. For the most part, humans either have worshipped them or coveted them and harvested them and made them into their own ideas.
Right. I love abstract art and abstract artists, but actually Mother Nature is the supreme abstract artist. The way that the stones speak to you, the way the rocks talk to you, dictates a lot of the time the ultimate finished product, correct?
It does. It doesn't matter if you're a carver or a painter. Nature's voice, if you're not listening to that, you're missing a whole lot of vocabulary. And we are all those things, water and earth, minerals. We should give it all back and revere it while we get to walk on it.
And then, of course, we all return to the earth when we're done with this life of ours. Stones represent to me, especially the way that you work with them, they represent energy, the energy that it took to for Mother Nature to shape the stone over eons, the energy to quarry and to transport and to erect the stones. And when I see something like an Art City stone garden sculpture, I can feel the energy just emanating from these sculptures of yours.
Well, that's nice, because that's why they're spaced and organized in a way that each one has room to breathe. This big stone behind you here, I haven't probably been through some 20 chaparral fires, hundreds of chaparral fires over the years, and it makes spalling pop off the surface. And this was right on the top of the mountain. This was the top of the mountain. So the texture then is what came as a result of that. The stone around the corner here, this stone has a lot of the same textural things. They're a part of how the mountain exfoliates anyway. So it didn't, this was exposed as a result of quarrying. It rolled out of a hole in the ground, and that was the shape. And the shape is rare among stones exfoliating out of the mountain with bulldozer aid or whatever happens. So this was the tallest, most kind of exotic stone, well, the most exotic stone on the other side of the yard that I've ever been able to collect. This one's so tall, it has a pin in the bottom.
I was going to ask you how you keep a top-heavy stone of many tons properly balanced on your pedestal. So you have a pinning technique, is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Go ahead and elaborate on that for a minute.
Well, we drill the bottom stone with a 9-inch bore. So we have a 9-inch, half-inch pipe in there, and it goes 3 feet up into this stone. That's a temporary pinning, because we don't know what the permanent install will be. But that's for being able to install, deinstall without affixing it in any permanent way.
Pinning a stone such as this to its pedestal represents, again, more energy. And how many man hours of absolutely raw energy are you putting into pinning something of this sort together?
Well, in this particular case, it was 20 hours of work to drill and cut the pipe and get it ready and prepare it. Partly we had to prepare this stone in San Diego before it came here. Otherwise I'd had to have the crane twice, which is a lot more than 20 hours of man hours.
I see. Ladies and gentlemen, we're speaking with the wonderful Paul Lindhard, the proprietor here at Art City Stone Gardens. Paul took over what was a vacant lot, weeds and rock and stones and pebbles, and he resurrected and created this wonderful sculpture garden with absolutely beautiful organic gardens along the perimeter of the stone gardens. Let's go visit a garden plot, shall we, Paul?
All right. Well, it's a regular natural garden, because not everything we have grown here is in a cave.
What are these, Indian squash?
Chayote. It's a Mexican squash that grows on a vine. And I grew them to...
Right from these vines here?
Right from these vines here. They're hanging in there. Going to come off of here like crazy.
Beautiful.
Fabulous food.
They're loving it here. What do we have behind us here?
This is a poodled up, a shaped weeping mulberry. It does fruit, and the fruit is pretty tasty once it matures.
Very tasty. They become like a purple in color. Black, they become black and beautiful.
This was an Italianesque garden through here. With some cilantro. We harvested a bunch of things already.
What I'm attracted to are these wonderful, mostly, are these sandstone planter perimeters here? What are these?
A schist that comes from out in the Mojave, a quarry out there. And I got it from my neighbor across the street. They were remnants from a job. It's frequently, all the stone on the perimeter of this garden, which is like 18 tons of material, gets thrown away, go to the landfill.
Well, unbelievable. Is schist what some of the Native Americans used to use to make arrowheads from?
No, that's chert. Schist is it's frequently in bands and is like granite in a lot of its ways. But it's own animal. It is a schist vein through granite, then it's granite with a schist vein.
Beautiful piece of granite.
That bends at the waist, almost 50% off camber, and is dead level and balanced. It's just super rare stone, and it's flawless.
Is it a particular type of granite? What is it?
It's a gabbro granite. All the granite in the yard is a gabbro granite. This is from Escondido. The rest of it's from it's called the Academy Quarry, and it's up by Yosemite.
Beautiful. We understand that you're a very busy gentleman. This is a Saturday afternoon. Your Art City Studios and Stone Supplies is open on Saturdays. Are you open on Sundays as well?
Yes, we are.
Okay, give us your address once again, would you?
197 Dubbers Street, Ventura, California. Okay. 001.
197 Dubbers Street, ladies and gentlemen. That's just off of West Main Street in Ventura, past Avon Shopping Center. You turn right on Olive, you turn left on Rex, and then it curves onto Dubbers Lane. And Paul, you'll see the Art City Stone Garden straight ahead before you curve to the right. And Art City Stone Studios is two more lots down on your left. You can't miss it. Paul Lindhard, thank you so much for your time today.
You're welcome, Rob. Thanks for having me.
And we'll be right back. Well, that brings us to the end of another episode of Gardens of Ventura County, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to thank our proprietor and founder of Art City and Art City Stone Gardens, Paul Lindhard, for his gracious time and participation in the program. And I'd like to thank you at home for joining us here on another episode of Gardens of Ventura County. We'll see you next time.